Okay, we start.
I need the microphone.
Hello. Yeah, works. Okay, excellent. Thank you very much. My name is Christian Felcam. I'm from Argentina. And we are going to have a panel today that I'm really proud to moderate, because it's going to show how the Americas is working. So, yeah. Oh, that's good. Thank you, Ika, for hosting this. First, for being in the COP, such an important place to discuss this huge challenge that we have in on the climate crisis and the climate change. And it's extremely important for us from Argentina, from our organization, to say that we are farmers and the whole industry of food production is committed with coping with the climate change. And today we are going to have a panel showing how it works. Yeah, first then, Manuel Eteri is going to address us with some words of welcome. Address.
Thank you, Federico. Good morning, everyone. And welcome once again to the House of Sustainable Agriculture of the Americas. We are very proud to have many, many sessions to discuss the present and especially the future. The future, what is at the stake with agriculture? I don't have any doubt that agriculture in the continent is undergoing a very, very structural reform in which sustainability is a buzzword, is a key word. And a knowledge-intensive agriculture is the future, with farmers, pro-nature, and with long-term-based policies. Fortunately, all agriculture ministers in the continent have agreed upon several messages. We are just one voice in the continent, and we are going to discuss with other counterparts the future of the world, because the continent is a guarantor, no question about it, of the food security and the environmental sustainability. So welcome once again, and I will be eager waiting for the results of this session.
Thank you very much. We are going to start this session with Marcelo Torres. Marcelo is Vice President of APRESID. It's a well-known Society of Farmers in Argentina, extremely worried with the sustainability since the beginnings of APRESID. And also he has been director of the Sistema Chakras, which is a research on farm, on sustainable agriculture, which is extremely important as well. Marcelo, you are going to give a presentation with the PowerPoint. So yes. I ask you to say next so they can move from one to that.
Thank you, Christian. Thank you, Ika, for inviting us as a farmer organization to be part of this its pavilion. It's a great opportunity to share our vision and experience in such important setting, and share this panel with other partner organizations like CREA and GPS, with whom we work in many opportunities. Today, we are going to talk about climate smart production systems, nature-based solutions, and the leading role of the farmers. Next, please. This is the title. Next, please. The Argentine No-Till Farmers Association is an NGO compromise of farmers and agronomists. We have 30 years of history, 800 members, influence across 11 million hectares in our country and other countries also. Present in Argentina, South America, Africa, and participation in international forum. Over 900 producers leading research and development projects in our properties on over different topics. Next one, please. Our mission, to promote sustainable food, fibers, and energy production. How do we do it? Developing systems that optimize production with lower environmental impact. Promoting innovation in network. This is the key, innovation in networks. Next, please. We talk about conservation agriculture. We believe in the constant evolution of our productive systems. Here we can show what the system is based on. Its pillar, no-till, is the basement. Intensification and diversification using different crops, summer or winter crops, and using cover crops, ecosystems, service crops, and integrate nutrient management. We believe in layers that overlap with one another. We see very often that fall in temptation to rename our way to doing agriculture or livestock production, sometimes throwing out the accumulated empirical and scientific knowledge. Next, please. How do the system we promote impact on the emission dynamics? Improves the balance of emission, double capture the carbon in the soil, reduce 40% our CO2 equivalent emission, triple the contribution of organic carbon to the system, and triple the kilograms of grain, per kilogram of CO2 emitted equivalent. This is important. Repeat, triple the kilograms of grain per kilogram of CO2 equivalent emitted. Reduce in a half to requirements for synthetic fertilizers, especially nitrogen. And this is very important to the climate change. Next, please. We can see planting green. Planting on green ecosystem service. We use species and their blends to control weeds, to capture more carbon. Next, please. Avoid long chemical follows. Next, please. We can see different cover crops. We plant in green, or we could cut the cycle of the in a mechanical way or chemical way to the cover crops. Next, please. Other benefits of this agriculture. We 700 million tons of soil that we stop losing through erosion all over the world. 25% plus water productivity. More grain per millimeter of water. 28% in year. 13% more stability. Reduce 60% use of fossil fuels. Reduce environmental impact in a half due to less use of phytosanitary products. Improves the soil biological activity and his diversity, biodiversity. Next, please. First farmer get together and detect the limiting factors to adapt these systems in this region. We have a big country, a long country, spanning north to south with varied climates from subtropicals, temperature, and semi-arid climates. We summon science, this is the first step. In the second step, we summon science and technology companies to work together with farmers. Farmers assume the leadership to the central part of these changes. The spread of knowledge between farmers is higher because we have an important capacity of observation and we can quickly adapt the other farmers' ways to producing when we see that other farmers in our region obtain better results and are more sustainable. Sustainable solutions are effective, applicable, and scalable. Next, please. This is the no-till surface evolution. You can see this is the surface in Argentina. This is South America. This is the rest of the planet, the global situation. We need to close this gap. We need to focus in close this gap. Next, please. Appreciate member of CAPAS, Confederation of American Association for Sustainable Agriculture. The other members are organizations for Brazil, Paraguay, Uruguay, Mexico, among others. We are working incorporating a new members from the other American countries. Next, please. South America is a relevance in global fat production. ...50% of the market of grain, 54% of global trade of soybean, 28% world market of meat, 39% of world market on chicken meat, and just 3.2% of world population. We have a very important role to eat. In this, in produce food for all over the world. Next, please. Next. Farmers want to be part of the solution, but we need to want to know, what part of the problem we are talking about. This part of the problem. Less than 20% on greenhouse gases emission. Sitting entrepreneurs at the discussion table, together with policymakers and science, can be a shortcut to quickly take action, and it can be viable for all activities. Public-private articulation is the key. Next, please. We have enough knowledge. We have enough technology. We have enough goals. We need to work in integration. We need to work in integration, engagement, articulation with companies, universities, research institutes, governments, international organizations, citizenry, and environmental NGOs. We don't have this time in renaming things. We have to talk about the principles of conservation agriculture and grow on the surface with this model adapted locally by farmers with sustainable in three axes: environmental, economical, and social. Next, please. This is our network with companies, scientific institutions, international organizations like ICA, governments, provincial, nationals, other institutions and organizations. It's a big network. Next, please. We're working in Gran Chaco. Can we complement caring for native vegetation with sustainable production? What practice do we need? What carbon footprint they have? Can we generate opportunity for farmers to capture the value of lower carbon footprint? The scope are 50,000 hectares. We have to work on landscape design and productive systems to protect biodiversity, allow development, and take care of the planet and the bioma. Next, please. You need to close the carbon gaps. We work with information about our soils, information about the weather, harmonization of information using simulation model, we could find the potential capture, and we need to close this gap. This is carbon farming. This is important activity to develop. Next, please. Climate smart product models. How does no-till and good agricultural practice impact life in soils and its biodiversity? How does they impact carbon sequestration and greenhouse gases emission? Can we design production models adapted to environments of the area that allow to maximize production with the less amount of emissions? Next, please. Some conclusion. What we can collaborate with, our productive models are allies against climate change, contributing with systemic and nature-based solutions. Our model of innovation in networks has proven effectiveness and is capable of generating actual sustainable solutions that respond to the needs of the producers that are applicable and scalable. What are our challenges? We need a compromised citizenry, especially in developed countries, that choose food with lower carbon footprint and traceability as guaranteed of sustainable origins. Conservation agriculture must be part of the global agenda to combat the climate change. Just Argentina has 90% of this agriculture under conservation agriculture. I mean, the first step, the no-till system. We need to work a lot together. We need the world's commitment to his model and take the action, go in the same direction to the speeches. Sectors and countries that contribute the most global emissions must commit with concrete and effective mitigation actions. We are at the turning point where humanity must sustain a growing demand on food while also taking care of the planet. In agriculture, we are on the eve of the fifth agricultural revolution. The no-till system with crop rotation and use of ecosystem service crop. The first revolution was the domestication of plants and animals. The second was crop rotation to prevent plant diseases. The third revolution was industrialization, synthetic products, and mechanization. The fourth revolution was genetic improvement, the Green Revolution, led by Norman Borlaug. We are now at the point where we must sustain the growing demand with less impact. And this production model based on no-till, keeping our lands green, using live plants as long as possible and supported by working in networks with science and technology are the answer. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Marcelo. I think it was a very interesting presentation. You mentioned beforehand that to cope with climate change should be done with farmers, but it's such a complex challenge that we have. It's extremely important to learn from each other, and you show an example of how to learn and to produce and to develop new technologies in order to be to generate these possible solutions. We are part of the solutions in the food industry, in the farmer sector. And next, we're going to have Bob Love. Bob is past president of the Canadian Cattle Association and actual incoming vice president of the Global Roundtable for Sustainable Beef. Bob is part of a long line of ranchers that came to Alberta in the late 800s, and you continue the legacy with cow-calf and also feedlot. The livestock sector usually is pointed out as to blame from part of the problem, and we are convinced that we are part of the solution. So, Bob, what is the position of Canada and your position on this topic?
Well, thank you. And first, I'd really like to thank Ika for inviting me to this. And I don't think I can add any more than what Marcelo has already said. I think I start out here a little bit about myself, but that's already been said. So we need to understand that producers are the first to feel the effects of climate change, and as such need to be the first to respond. We believe that the three-legged stool approach, environmentally friendly, socially responsible, and economically viable, is the only way that this is going to work. If any leg in that system collapses, the whole system collapses. Farmers around the world, from small to large, no matter what the political climate, live in the environment. They don't get to look at the environment in their air-conditioned cars, or in our case where I'm from, in our heated cars. It's minus 24 in Canada right now, where I'm from. And the other thing that I think a lot of people forget is farmers need to be economically viable. Whatever they do needs to be socially accepted. And this is where we face challenges. In order to produce food that is environmentally friendly and economically viable, we need to be allowed to use the science. In North America, the trend is to bigger and bigger farms due to smaller and smaller margins. While the implementation technology is not cheap. And while the implementation does increase margins, it takes a certain amount of units to pay for it. In our case, we use satellite mapping to map our fields as we seed, spray, and harvest. Computers in the tractors keep track of the inputs and the production, creating a history down to the square meter. The system then places the fertilizer on a variable rate per square meter, which decreases fertilizer use and increases the returns without decreasing production. Science has developed the ability for sprayers to recognize undesirable species in a crop and selectively spray just that individual plant. This technology is currently in the field testing stages, as I understand it. Cattle become a bit more controversial, but the same principles apply. The use of growth-enhancing technology, while safe, climate-friendly, and economically viable, is not socially accepted in many parts of the world. People in the Western world want an inexpensive and reliable supply of food, but are skeptical about the science used to supply it. The awareness and adoption of controlled grazing practices, while not new, the American bison figured it out thousands of years ago, leads to an increase in the biodiversity of both plants and animals. In Canada, 68% of wildlife exists on 33% of the agricultural land. That's predominantly grazing land, as well as increasing the carbon storage. If a plant's green, it's storing carbon. Done well, it also increases the producer's bottom line. I know I should have this memorized. Confined feeding operations, while controversial in some circles, can also contribute to food security and help reduce greenhouse gas emissions. The rumen allows a cow to turn waste products into a nutrient-dense food. The consumption of starch compared to carbohydrates leads to less methane production. Also, they enable cattle to be fed products that would otherwise go to landfills. In Canada, landfills are the second largest contributors to methane release. In our case at home, we feed, depending on what we get, 25 to 50 tons of waste vegetables, fruits and vegetables to cattle every week. This is perfectly good food that for some reason the grocery store shelves didn't make it to the grocery store shelves. This would otherwise go to a landfill. We need to understand the circular economy and all types of food production are essential. We also need to understand that everything that comes out of academia or special interest groups is not always applicable on the land. I'm encouraged by the increased interest in things like animal nutrition, grazing management, and soil health. I believe satellite mapping and computer technology, combined with the brilliance and exuberance of youth, will allow food to be produced within the boundaries of the three-legged stool. Someone once said, it's not the strongest nor the smartest that will survive, but those most adaptable to change. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Bob. We move from crop production to livestock production with the same commitment of reducing greenhouse gas emissions. And we have the chance not only to have from the South Cone, from Argentina to Canada, in the Americas showing this commitment, but also from the private sector to the public sector. So we have Cecilia Jones. Cecilia, you're part of the Ministry of Livestock and Agricultural Production in Uruguay. And please introduce a bit of yourself and also how is coping Uruguay with this challenge? Because you have a lot of things undergoing now. So please share us.
Thank you very much. So a little bit about myself. I coordinate the unit of sustainability of climate change within the Ministry of Livestock and Fisheries in my country, in Uruguay. And I'm also a farmer, I'm a livestock farmer. I produce beef in natural grasslands in Uruguay. And I also have, I lease some land to people that do agriculture, no-till agriculture. So, but I'm not gonna talk as a farmer here. I'm gonna talk about as a member of the public institution. And the one message that I get from what I heard, and that's where we stand, is how to take science, make it into policies, so that we can produce safe food that is traceable and has lower environmental impact. Here today, we are in the Convention for Climate Change, but we talk about these things more as an impact on the environment. And like Marcelo said, it's not just greenhouse gases. It's greenhouse gases, the load of nutrients that we put into the systems and how we keep everything in balance so that it is sustainable. So Uruguay has a strong policy on sustainable agriculture, and we've been working on translating science into policies. And I'm gonna talk about a couple of examples of things that we have done to bridge that gap and to provide tools that help farmers sell their products with value, that environmental value added in their tag. So one of the policies has to do with the no-till agriculture crop production. And Uruguay has a policy where every farm that produce grains in a surface that is more than 50 hectares has to present to the Ministry of Agriculture a plan for the use of the soil that includes no-till farming. It does not allow for monocropping, so you do have to do a crop rotation where we encourage, well, it's mandatory basically, the rotation with grasses and say, for example, soybean and grasses have to rotate yearly, to allow for the buildup of organic matter in the soil, to allow for the soil health to be sustained or improved. What this is based on is on science. It's just a policy that translates science into a practical tool. So what does science tell us? Science tells us that if we have, say, 3 years or 4 years of pasture and 3 years of crops, then we are increasing carbon storage in the soil. And that's what we're looking for. It also tells us, science also, is also telling us that if the rotation is slower, okay, say we don't have 4 years of pasture in our rotation, we have less than that, 3-to-1 ratio. Then we are, what we're doing at that time is stopping the carbon loss to the atmosphere. That with this, they're basically simple rules based on very strong science that tell us how to do agriculture without losing carbon and with enhancing the carbon sinks in the soil. So as a public policy that puts the farmers in a good position where he said, okay, this is the way we're doing our farming. The products that we sell have this guarantee with them. Regarding livestock production, Uruguay has a universal individual traceability system for all cattle, all beef cattle, not for sheep. And we are working together with the academia, farmers, and all the technical officers of the ministries to assess what is the environmental impact of livestock production in the country. So we're working on life cycle assessments with carbon footprint at a national level, and we have it in very small local regions. We are calculating what is the carbon footprint of our beef. And another thing that was mentioned by the previous speakers is we want to lower the intensity of emissions. That's what we're looking for. We want to keep producing food that has environmental value added to it, that has guarantees that are backed up by science, strong science, and by public policies that are coherent and consistent through time. Environmental footprint of livestock production includes, as I said, the greenhouse gas emissions, environmental impact, and also impact on biodiversity. We're calculated at a national level with very small grain, what is the integrity of ecosystems in livestock production systems. And one of the results this work did that was launched a few weeks ago is livestock production system on natural grasslands are the livestock production system that have more biodiversity index, integrity of biodiversity in the ecosystems. So the message again is, if we have strong science, we can build practical policies that support the farmers in their products and contribute to sustainable food production systems on all the dimensions. Not just greenhouse gases, but also biodiversity, nutrient, water quality, and water quantity.
Thank you very much, Cecilia. You introduced the public policy component, which is critical. And this challenge that we have with the climate crisis requires alignment, an alignment of farmers, working together to introduce new practices, public policies, research is extremely important to not only to reduce or to increase the intensity, the efficiency of our livestock systems, but also to start to sequester more and more carbon. As you mentioned, that you are having some numbers in Uruguay, which are really interesting to share. But then we have to align with the market. And Marcelo already told us that it's extremely important to align with the market. And then we have Eduardo Bustos, which is working at MyCarbon in Minerva Foods. He's the chairman of Climate Collection and leader of Sustainability Committee of the Brazilian Agribusiness Association. Eduardo has a really long list of institutions and companies where you have been working, but always with this focus on sustainability. Please, Eduardo, share with us the view of the industry.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Muchísimas gracias por la invitación, Ica, Manuel. I'm really happy to be here and hearing all of you. In the end of the day, the main opportunity that we have ahead is in July this year, we export the first cargo of carbon neutral beef in the world. So everything that we heard here can be translated in the end of the day in a rebuy in a supermarket all over the world that you can eat and have the certainty, because we have traceability, full traceability, that yes, it is possible to eat beef or use leather with a zero emissions. All the emissions are compensated. Actually, in Latin America, and love to hear, you know, when you see the potential of Americas, if you sum all Americas, we know we are the breadbasket of the world, but we can do much more. We can help to give the solution, a real solution of climate change, because the numbers are quite similar when you think about carbon capture. So we can capture much, much more than we emit. And then we can offer carbon credits to the world that a lot of countries in the world cannot do that. We can. So we can work together. Also, not to source food, feed, fiber, fuel, but also we can help to source carbon credits. It's exactly what we've done. 2 weeks ago, I was in Saudi Arabia hosting the biggest auction of carbon credits in the world. We were there offering, we were the biggest offers of carbon credits over there 2 weeks ago. So that's the reality. It's occurring right now. And we cannot do that without ranchers, without governments, without research institutes, and a lot of other partners in the value chain that are working really hard to make it happen. And we are doing that. So this is the essence of my presentation. I think the next one, and if you want to jump to next, please. But when we decided, no, when Minerva Group decided to create MyCarbon, the next one, please. The main idea here, it's MyCarbon, it's owned 100% by Minerva. Minerva is the biggest export of beef in the world, and sourcing beef mostly from Latin America and Australia. So those are the two main regions for us as a hub. We are the number one, number two in Brazil, number one in Uruguay, number one in Argentina, number one in Colombia, number one in Paraguay. So we have a very strong footprint in Latin America. Next one, please. And the main idea here for us, it's we are working in three pillars. No, we want to be the biggest developer of carbon credits, high quality carbon credits, which means nature-based solution credits. In the world, we want to source 100 million tons of carbon credits. For those that are working carbon credits, you know that it's a huge amount of carbon. But we know we can do it because we source beef for more than 50 million hectares. That's the beauty of beef. No, we are really close to more than 40,000 ranchers every day. And we can work much closer, you know, to generate those carbon credits by regenerating pasture lands, into agriculture, into integrated systems or forests. There's a lot of other opportunities. We also working in carbon credits. So in some cases, some clients want carbon credits, you know, from mangroves, blue carbon, for example. So, okay, we can work with partners and then we can help to source. And for sure, because we are inside Minerva, we have, okay, we have a lot of opportunities to add value in the products that we have, in the beef, in the leather, and a lot of other products that, again, we can showcase that in the end product. So when you drive a car, you will drive a car saying, okay, there's a leather. That leather comes from Americas, and then we have a neutralized car. Wow, what amazing story that we can build, and we are doing that. Next, please. So those are the three main pillars of our strategy. So we are working, probably you heard a lot, you will hear a lot these those 2 weeks about Red Plus, no, the last branch about the forest conservation. Red Plus is the most abundant carbon credits in a nature-based solution. It is really important. We do have a lot of, I heard here, you know, from Chaco region, for example, the Amazon, Cerrado, Pampas, a lot of biomes all over Americas that we can shop, but we can take a decision to keep that, to preserve, to conserve. If we do that, we can generate carbon credits. It's the easiest way to generate carbon credits in land. But we also have a huge opportunity here to restore degraded pastures. In the whole Americas, we have more than 200 million hectares of degraded pastures. 200 million, guys, it's almost the size of Argentina, one of the biggest countries in the world. So that's the size of the challenge, but also the size of opportunity that we have in our hands. So we can recover degraded pasturelands into new pasturelands and then generate carbon credits, ALM carbon credits. Red Plus credits value something around $10. ALM values at least $20 per ton. So there's a difference. And then the fanciest I can say here, carbon, it's ARR, which is afforestation or reforestation, revegetation. So grow trees, we can plant eucalyptus, we can plant acacia or even native species. No, those are $30 credits, so even better, but for sure the cost is much higher. So we do have a lot of opportunities, and from our value chain, we have at least 10 million hectares that we can work together to convert to generate carbon credits. Again, not just to the region, but all over the world. Next one. And so we are running a project but named Renove. Grace, if she's here with us, Grace is leading that project. For sure, we cannot enter in the carbon market if you want to walk the talk. So we are doing our own job. So inside Minerva Group, we are committed to get net zero by 2035. And then next one, please. Just an example, we do have maps from all over Latin America, but because we have a traceability in every farm that we source, we know the land use. And by knowing the land use, we can work with ranchers to take the best decision about, okay, what we're going to do. We will recover the degraded pasturelands. We will include, like in Pampas, we will include raygrass to increase the carrying capacity. And then at the same time that we're increasing carrying capacity, we are increasing the carbon sequestration in the soil. Do not forget, probably the most important message here, no, carbon in agriculture means productivity. And that's the beauty of the systems, because when you work to generate carbon credits, we must generate organic matter. And by generating organic matter, we are increasing productivity. So that's the essence. And then next one, please. So we have this program to engage to attach green finance. For me, it's one of the, it's still today, the huge opportunities, like missing opportunities, which is still have time, no, but a missing opportunity for all of us is how can we connect better the green finance and our sector? Because we know that I'm a rancher, and thanks for mentioning, I am a rancher in Goiás state. And we know that, don't blame the cows, but a lot of people still today, they're blaming the cows. So when we ask to a bank, okay, we need $200 to apply phosphorus in Pampa region and add a regress. Oh, it's really nice idea, but we cannot give loans to livestock because, you know, you are the bad guys. No, we are not. So, but we do have this challenge to help to educate the investors, to them to understand that, yes, we are part of the solution of the climate change. And then we have to work in capacity building and technical partnerships. As you mentioned, I love the ring. No, I appreciate all the partners. This is exactly what we are doing on it. So in the next one. So we are tracking carbon footprint, give access to low interest rate finance, tracking the helping farmers to understand their powerful the power that they have, you know, to show to be a part of the solution, but actually showcase all over the world what we are doing in the region. Next one, and then that's what we've done so far. So we asked to 10 farmers in Uruguay, in the north of Uruguay, that send our the cattle to pool plant. And we track from the farm, all the farm carbon emissions, the industry emissions, which means in that case specifically, our emissions in pool facility in the north of Uruguay. We get the logistics to the destination. In that case, with the first cargo in the world, we sent to Blockhaus, the biggest steakhouse in Germany. So to pool factory, to Montevideo, Montevideo, Hamburg, Hamburg, to Berlin, to their station, and then to the steakhouse. And then we have the emissions reduction plan, something around 28 tons per ton. And then we add ryegrass, we add phosphorus, because the soil in Pampas in general, they are very poor in phosphorus. We get to 28 to 8. And then we plant eucalyptus with Arauco, and then zero. Okay, that's it's not that difficult, to be honest. But the challenge again, no, is how can we get this long-term partnership? We know that all over the world. I am proudly a founding member of GRSB, a really happy congrats for you folks to keep doing a great business. But I travel all over the world seeing livestock in most of the countries, all over the world. It's a spot business, no? Which means that you wake up in the morning and you take the decision to sell the beef, you will sell the beef. So here in the carbon markets, we are talking about 30 years contract. So yes, it's not that easy, you know, to do that. But then if you don't have enough carbon generating in the farm, we can buy in the market and then compensate. It's exactly what we've done. To prove that, yes, it's possible. Next one. And so we have this certification. So if the buyer, if they want to do that, they have the certificate. We are using the VCM 42. So we can generate VERA carbon credits if another company, not a beef company or a leather company, if they want to buy only the carbon credit, we can separate that. So we still exporting beef, no, but we can add carbon or we can sell carbon in separated. Next one, I think this is the final one. So again, my next, yeah, it's we can do it. We are doing it, and but we can do much more if we work much closer. And again, I know, send my regards to Fernando. We did that we have a very nice event in Dubai a couple weeks ago, telling that story. And we have a lot of air companies coming to us say, okay, I want 10 million tons. Oh, so good. Congratulations. We will get there in 3 years. No, so it will take time. We know that. But it will take 3 years if you start now. If you take 3 years, if you start in 3 years, it's 6 years. So let's start now. Let's start together. We can do it. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Eduardo. Eduardo, you're giving us a lot of optimism about the possibilities that we have. If we have the alignment of the industry, of the public sector and the farmers. I think we are all ranchers at the end of the day. And we know that to blame the cows is a shortcut, which is leading us to bad solutions. Because just to give you an example, in Argentina, we have 120 million hectares that if we don't use it with livestock, beef and sheep, would be the biggest national park of the world. But it's nonsense because of the food security that we need to assure, and Latin America and the whole Americas has a huge and critical role in to assure this. That doesn't mean that we do not acknowledge the climate change problem and challenge and that we have to be working now to get the solution, because they are really long-term solutions. There is no quick fix for this. So we have a bit of time, so there's some questions from the public. We would love to get some questions from the audience. So what else?
Yes, Pablo Ferrer, the Redes Chaco, the Argentina, Bolivia, and Paraguay is a big platform. Well, I say and I ask you the challenge, how to include in this process the Scalab small farmers. It's difficult to access to technology, to carbon market. It's very difficult. We think that it's impossible. So how do you think you can work together with networks, with different organizations? How we do it to include this high number of people, perhaps not high number of surface, but high number of people who produce livestock or agriculture, seeds? What do you think?
Edu, it's very close. Okay. The question is to Edu. In this work, what would be the biggest challenge you have is to engage the producers? It's a guess.
Yes. One of the biggest challenges, when you think about, for example, Brazil, we have almost 180 million hectares of pasture lands, 3.5 million ranchers. But actually, almost three are double use. So it's dairy and beef, which means in the end of the day, they're not good in none of them. We know that. For us, we understand that. Like, if you want to keep a dairy, okay, have a dairy cattle. If you want a beef cattle, but the challenge for most of those farmers, again, the ideal number is if you have more than 10,000 hectares. Okay, go and have your carbon credits. If you have less than 10,000, don't do that. It will cost much more than you will make it. So, okay, tell me a farmer with more than 10,000, rancher with more than 10,000 hectares, just a few in the whole Americas, actually all over the world, except in just specific places in the center of Brazil and some places in Australia that you can find no huge farmers, huge ranchers. We do have in our value chain a rancher with 450,000. It's ridiculous. But for example, my family, we have 350. So we cannot generate in my family. It will cost $250,000 to get the carbon credits. So the answer is quite simple. We know it's not simple, but it's association. Could be cooperatives, could be association, but could be a trader, that can help to aggregate. So aggregate, it's the main challenge here. Once you did that, you can bring more than 10,000 hectares. You can ask us or any partner. We have EcoSecurities here. We have a lot of other partners that can do a very great job to generate the PDD, the project development, and then submit the project, But again, most of the projects, the carbon projects in the world, the buyers, they want more than 30 years. The average is 30 years contract. 30 years. Okay, Minerva, we are the biggest exporter, beef exporter in the world. We do have 30 years. We were founded in 1992. So imagine when I come back to the company, now I'm working in the company, and I say, okay, guys, we will sign agreement with ranchers with 30 years. We can sign an agreement for 5. No? So we know this is the challenge there. The challenge to change the way that we've been working. And again, it's not just because you say, there's no trust. There is trust, but the reality is livestock comparing to non-tillage, for example, crops. Thank you. Gracias. to non-tillage, we are celebrating 50 years of non-tillage in Brazil. No, and we think about recovering degraded pastorelands. It's 10 years project. No, the ABC program in Brazil, we have 10 years. So there's a difference of maturity in the sectors. But again, maturity and governance probably is the best word, no, means open dialogue and a clear understand that everyone needs everyone to move ahead. Otherwise, we will not speed up in or accelerate as fast as we want and as fast as the world needs. That's the challenge. We are facing a food crisis, but also we are facing a climate crisis. I don't know, and I know more than 80 countries. I don't know a region in the world like America's that can help to address this issue like us. So we have to work together to bring more associations to solve the issue and to bring this transparency, more transparency and to bring that.
I wanna add a little bit to the original, your question about the farmer scale and how they can. I think it's working. The one characteristic of our food producing system is their heterogeneity. And from the public policy sector, that's one of the biggest challenges, because we there's no one solution. There's a number of solutions. And I'll go back to what I said, that we need information, we need strong science, and the recipe for each scale of production is different. The challenges are different. And I think that's where public policies play a big role of trying to bring whoever is being left behind, bring it up to the environmental challenges that need to be faced and the environmental solutions that need to be applied. So I think that's a place where public policies play an important role. And everything that Minerva does, it can do it because there are strong institutions behind. In the case of Uruguay, we have the traceability system that is, okay, this is transparent information, it's official data that can be used to build trust for markets. The role we have is just to make sure that no one's left behind. And the one thing that you mentioned is, okay, farmers, the challenge for farmers is their environmental challenges, their adaptation to climate change, and the issues, local issues. So we have to work globally, we have to think long term, but the solutions that you need are the solutions that work for you. And that it's not just one. And being able to make a profit, it's crucial, and being able to appropriate that environmental value added, I think it's just unfair, not unfair, but unfair, that farmers can't do that. That somehow, whatever the work is done on the field, that's where the work is done. The work that Minerva is selling, just to put it in a way, it's been done long term every day on the fields, and I think that's something that it's very important for everybody to know. I know that here it's like preaching to the choir of the church. I'm sure everybody that's sitting here somehow knows everything what we're saying. It's on their minds. I'm pretty sure, but I think that's the message we have to give. That there's a lot of heterogeneity, that this is slow and long-term, and being steady and working long-term, it's the only solution that from my sector, from the policy, is the only that we can.
Yeah, just a really quick answer to your question about how do you get farmers involved. In Canada, we've got the Canadian Roundtable for Sustainable Beef, and we actually have a certified sustainable stamp if you go through X criteria. The total amount of dollars that the restaurants that are involved are paying is $60 to $80 a head, which is pretty big money when the average return in feeding cattle is about $18 a head. We still can't get enough people on board. I think to what you said, it's not a 5-year plan, it's a 25-year plan. And eventually through young people, through knowledge and information sharing, it'll become the norm. But I don't believe there's a quick solution. When we're paying in Canada, we're paying, you know, good money to meet the criteria to become sustainable, and we still can't get enough producers to become sustainable. For various, part of that is lack of lack of government acknowledgement might be the best way to put it. We don't have enough certified vets to license the farms to do the thing, and that's really not a producer problem. There is demand from producers, but still not enough.
I know, Marcelo, you have, and then we go to Ian.
An example, we create a fund to the small and medium farmer, create a fund to invest in agtech. I think the organizations need to help to little and medium farmers to create association. It's not easy, but it's the way to resolve some of these challenges. We need to help the little and medium farmers to create association. It's not so easy, but it's possible, and the organization need to help us to create this association. It's the way to resolve a lot of challenge and reach a lot of objectives.
Thank you very much. Jan, please.
Yes, hello, it's Jan Heinrich from Eco Securities. We work in the whole Latin America, looking for an originating carbon nature-based solutions, especially in cattle raising. And I was thinking, one of the big challenges is the uncertainties that we have on soil carbon and how we measure it, how we define the baseline and the way we increase soil carbon and the measurement. And in that sense, maybe we should work together on technology and research on how we can better eliminate uncertainties. And so talking about also a big challenge for us is how to build these associations on small and medium landowners. We are working on that, but it's a tough because of land tenure and legality. And then in order to get the money back from the carbon market to the landowners, if you have to split it through a lot of farmers, it's a huge work. And it gets so costly that is almost impossible. So we should get somehow a methodology to get these associations and a way of for them to split this money, no? That they are the last and the most, the owners of the carbon in the end, of the money that comes from the market. So, thank you.
I just want to say a comment. I don't think we have figured out how to have soil carbon tracking system. I don't think any country in the world has solved that question in a financially viable way yet. But that's where the science plays a huge role. I think that there will be a way, but I don't think anybody has it today.
I won't say that because I'm here in the IICA Pavilion, but I have to say that because it's a very good project, LISA, Living Soils of Americas. It's a part of the challenge that we have had to address. It's a common ground with science to bring the best way to track carbon soil, SOC, soil organic carbon. It's a huge challenge. No, if you want to hear more, on Saturday we have Hatan here explaining that. We have Sehi, we have a huge group of scientists helping to address that issue, as you mentioned. We have the VM42, but barely everything that we have today was developed by rich countries, temperated countries, to temperated regions, to sell carbon to temperated countries again. So it's not included the tropical world. And so we do have this huge opportunity ahead of us, you know, to bring the tropical agriculture, the rotational systems. No, when you think about integrating, we talk about 4-5 crops in 1 year. When I come, we come back to Veja, we know that. No, Veja said, how come? How it's not possible? I say, yes, for sure. No, we can do it. We can 5 crops a year. Wow. So how can we generate carbon credits? We have to bring science. But again, I think the beauty here, we talked, you mentioned now about the money. Again, a real number from the 10 farmers that we have in Uruguay, and actually a part of the answer to your question. They produce in average 100 kilos per hectare per year of beef, 100 kilos. When they add the carbon strategy, they start to produce 150. 50 kilos plus $5 per kilo, it's $250 more per hectare per year. We don't need carbon. That's the reality. We will have carbon. Don't get me wrong. But the reality is the farmer, the rancher, they will make 2 tons per hectare per year in Pampas region, probably in Brazil, Braquiarias in Colombia, part of, we will make 4 or 5 a year, but 2 tons per year. $20, it's $40. Carbon will make 40. Livestock will make, the productivity will make 250. You understand now? That's a real numbers. And again, in Uruguay, when you start that, we start with 10. You say, okay, let's move to 100. We have 300 now. And when we start, I was in Palermo attending La Rural. Those from Argentina, you will understand me. No, it's one of the biggest fairs in the world. And when you ask that, they say, despite all the challenges, no, that they have ahead, we are starting with 100 ranchers too. And that's the beauty, no, to bring science markets. And for sure, we know $20 is not enough for ALM. So, but we have to educate the buyers that our carbon, it's a much better carbon than oil and gas carbon, a renewable carbon. But, you know, it takes time. And if we work together to help to educate them, we can increase the price. And in the end of the day, it's good for all of us, because the price will come back directly to the rancher. You know, that's the, he owns the carbon credits. He will make the money on it. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Mary Robinson. I'm from Canada. I know Bob. I'm the president of the Canadian Federation of Agriculture, and I'm also the North American representative on the World Farmers Organization. And I just wanted to back up to a couple of comments that were made in regard to cooperatives and aggregating the small farmer contribution to capture the value for those small producers, small ranchers. WFO at our General Assembly in Budapest in June of this year, we developed a policy to empower small cooperatives. So in order to build those cooperatives, to bring those people together with proper governance and structure, we have an approach to that, and we can help your ranchers come together to capture this value and also to capture the recognition for the carbon work that they do.
Thank you.
You know, I have a lot of friends in the environment area, the NGOs defending the environment. And usually when we talk about livestock and agricultural sector, they used to believe that we are not worried about it, you know? That we felt under attack. And they are quite surprised when they realize that farmers in general, we are extremely not only worried but occupied with the climate challenges that we have, and extremely interesting to see and completely agree that we, most of the solutions are win-win solutions with productivity. So when we have the markets, the policies, and the producers wanted to share and wanted to learn and to apply these technologies and these new ways, because we have to recognize also that we have to improve the ways we are doing the things. But it is the history of the humankind. Always we have to improve. I would like to have your opinion on your countries and taking the advantage that you are not only representative of different institutions, but also ranchers or farmers yourself. What is your opinion on how the farmers in your countries are looking at these challenges of, are they keen to adapt or to adopt new technologies in regards to these challenges? How do you see them?
I can start here and then we go. No, so, but no, I think again, when I when we talk to ranchers all over Americas, no, but in Brazil specifically, there's a lot of challenges around deforestation. This is the topic number one. So every time that I talk to, I was in Geneva a couple of weeks ago attending a WTO meeting. And I've heard that from a minister of agriculture with a European country said, oh, we don't like you folks, but we need you because, you know, you are the fourth biggest producer in the world, third largest exporter in the world. We will export 140 billion this year. So probably we will be the third biggest surpassing US. And you know, like, but there's that challenge. And I made this joke, and I know not a nice joke, but I say, okay, you don't buy cattle from Rio Grande do Sul because we are the first state in the Amazon, but you buy from Uruguay, which is 53 kilometers, one of the packets that we have from the pool plant that we have. No, it's 53 kilometers far from the border. So you were saying that we cannot buy olive oil from Portugal because Russia invade Ukraine. Like the distance is the same from Lisbon to Moscow, you know, it's from Porto Alegre to Manaus in and say, oh, it's different. Say, no, it's not. But again, the challenge when you talk to ranchers, say, okay, carbon markets is a really, really nice thing, but you have to face deforestation. Something that we realize working the carbon markets is we cannot generate carbon credits with deforestation. So when I have a carbon credit generating in a ranch, it means in essence that there is no deforestation. It doesn't matter if it's legal or illegal, because now we are facing this due diligence. No, from Europe, a lot of challenges around due diligence, which is in essence a craziness because you get more inflation, food inflation. But we know that even in that space, carbon credits can help ranchers to prove in a real world with certification, with third party, that they're doing the best to the world. And there's a third party saying that, not they're saying that. So I think that this is the beauty also to get this opportunity to bring carbon, as you know, a sales idea to sell that to the world. But again, we have to be there. I was in Geneva attending that meeting. I was the only producer, and I was there like representing my company, not producer. So it's really important to get more producers. And I'm saying that a lot to CNA and the representatives in Brazil.
Short comment, huh? What I think is the challenge is climate change. That's the challenge. The challenge is in Uruguay, fewer days in the winter where we have frost that help us control parasites and diseases. The challenge is average temperatures that makes water deficit stronger and harder on our grasslands. The challenge is the change in rain patterns, where we have uncertainties about seasons and what the expected forage production will be. So going back to a comment that I did before, the challenges for the farmers are the local challenges. And that goes to small farmers and big farmers. And to the question on how to add technology or apply new techniques or practices, the challenges are on change of production are also dependent on each farm that can be constrained by all these climate challenges that I mentioned before. We have a program in Uruguay that works with cow-calf operations, very small cow-calf operations based on natural grasslands. And this is a program financed by GEF. And what we did is, Marcelo had said, is like, we have the knowledge. It just doesn't get to the people that are you're faced with those, all these short-term challenges. It's like, how do I get through this presently, right now? How do I get through this La Niña year that is making all the seasons not work the way my grandfather expected? And so we have the knowledge. We just need to be able to apply it to make our lives easier. And how to change all this uncertainties on the weather. There are ways of working in livestock production and natural grasslands, I'm talking, with more grass, with more that result in more soil organic carbon, that result in lower intensity of emissions, and that are built more resilient production systems. And in the end of the day, the vulnerability to climate change is what responds to the question that was put in the floor, and how people can have the tools to respond to this to these challenges.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Bob, which are the challenges that you see for the farmers and ranchers in Canada?
I think the biggest challenge, I'll go back a little bit, and I said that it's the ones with the ability to adapt are going to be the survivors. That's been agriculture since it started. The people in Canada that are farming and raising cattle right now have adapted to whatever's come along for 300 years in Canada. That's not the problem. I think people recognize that there is climate change and there's the threat that we're increasing carbon levels in the atmosphere. Personally, I'm not scared of carbon. If it wasn't for carbon, I wouldn't exist. And neither would you. We're made of carbon. The question becomes, how do we live with increased carbon in the atmosphere? Let's forget about the question of stopping carbon. And I think that's, in Canada, I think that's where most of the farmers and the ranchers are thinking is, we can do a lot of stuff. If it improves our bottom line, we're going to do it. And they always have done it, but a skeptical batch, I mean, they aren't going to do it right off the...
Well,
I don't know what that is.
I don't know if we are...
They aren't going to do it right off the bat. And and I'm speaking a lot from personal experience, the more that farmers get blamed in Canada and ranchers get blamed for destroying the environment, the stiffer their back becomes at saying, no, it's not us. We're going to do what we do. That whole conversation has to change. I think you said it best. The best thing I've heard today is, actions have to follow the directions of speeches, and that has not happened. So I think in order to get maybe people to adopt these things faster, you know, Canada, I don't think there's very much land that is not direct tilled anymore or no tilled. I really don't know of any in our area, but it's been a 20-year thing. Most of it caused because it saves money. Not makes money, it saves money. People understand that. The other thing that I have to wonder about sometimes is we talk about the small farms and the number of producers. When I keep hearing at home, whether it's right or not, I don't know, but 10% of producers are responsible for 90% of their production. In essence, 90% of the land. So do you actually start talking to those people as opposed to worrying about numbers of people? Do you worry about acres of land or hectares of land? Does that become the question?
Thank you very much. Marcelo, I ask you to very short comment on the challenges.
Very short. But the challenge is building a big network with policymakers, scientists, and building a long-term vision. Carl Sagan said that these are, Carl Sagan died in the 80s and said this time the people don't believe in science and form our own ideas and spread fast between the connection between us is very high. We need to work to data, to strong information, trying to connect people and came to the science, came to the strong data to take our decisions. We need to build high level discussion with information and with long term. This is our challenge, the long term vision and build a way to, we could be part of the solution. We need to be part of the solution. And we discuss with data, with information. This is our main challenge, I think.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. You mentioned, which are, no. Thank you very much. It's you mentioned the challenge is to integrate and to work together. Thank you very much, Manuel, because you guys hosting this and this allowing us to exchange ideas, to exchange views, and this the not only to show the world that we are working together, we are occupied solving this huge challenge, but also that we have still a lot of things to do. Thank you, Eduardo. Thank you, Cecilia, for your ideas. Bob, Marcelo, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.